Come, let us sing for joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol him with music and song. For the Lord is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care.
Shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is a thank you. small, child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. 'Cause Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain.
Thank you. is the Lamb to receive the reward of his suffering.
Jesus is my glorious day. This is the story of our eternity. And so, God, we just rest in the promises that you've given us. God, the sacrifice you made for our redemption. You're worthy to receive all the praise, the honor, the blessing, the glory, God, it's yours. So God, we just give this service to you. God, we pray that, God, that what it is you want us to hear, God, that it's spoken. Give us ears to hear. Lord, we also pray for the children as they go with Miss Lila this morning, God, that you would open their hearts, their minds, God, to more of you. Lord, we love you, and we pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Scripture this morning is Matthew chapter 4, verse 19. It says, "Come follow me," Jesus said, "and I will send you out to fish for people."
There it is. There we go. All right. Now I learned something. So good morning. This morning we're going to talk about fishing without a pole. In King James, Matthew 4:19 says, "Follow me and I will make you fishers of men." But as Richard explained in the New Living Testament, it says, "Come follow me and I will show you how to fish for people." And that's what my message that God gave me this morning about. Recently, Pastor Kathy just finished a series, Made for Missions. You know, session one, we talked about that we are called. Session two, we discussed what our mission was. Three, what's our message? Four, who is my mission? And five, why am I on a mission? So you're probably asking, why am I speaking today? Well, let me start with the what before the why. I was asked by Pastor Kathy to summarize either the lessons she'd given or to deliver my own message. But as many of you know, I have a heart for outreach. So this series really spoke to me heavily. And while that's not the why, that's the what. It's the message about outreach. The why is a little different. Recently, while discussing Encounter Ministries with some people at work, they commented Oh, that's right. I've seen your postings and the notes. You're a preacher. I let out a loud laugh, a very audible laugh. I said, oh, no, I am not a preacher. I just lead small group on Monday nights for our Zoom posts. I help lead post on Tuesday nights. I faithfully attend my church on Sundays, and I help where I'm needed, both with the church and encounter. But I don't preach. And I laughed again. 2 days later, Pastor Kathy contacted me and asked me to give today's message. I would like to read to you Matthew 4 and 7. You shall not tempt the Lord our God. Okay. So lesson learned. So that covers the why. So why are we going to talk about fishing without a pole? And why did Jesus relate to growing our kingdom of God as fishing? Seems like two different topics. At the time of Jesus, fishing was primarily done with nets, not poles. It's easy to catch more fish faster with a net than a pole. If you fish with a pole, you're fishing for one fish at a time. You have tunnel vision. One bait, one fish, one location, and you're constantly casting and reeling, replacing the bait that the turtles took, and this is an endless process. And at the end, you either have success or you have failure. However, with a net, you cast out a net, it covers a wide area. It floats through the water, it does all the work for you. Your only job was to put the net in the water. And this process greatly magnifies your yield. And why compare it to fishing? Well, any real fisherman will tell you it's called fishing because if it was a guarantee, it'd be called catching. While the Bible is filled with people turning their lives to God, stories about great fishermen and their amazing catches that went on to be great fishermen of their own, but it also accounts for those who, even when provided the greatest opportunity to do so, turned away. Most notably in the New Testament is Nicodemus, who knew that there was something more. He was a man of God. He knew the scripture, but he knew there was more. He was missing something. And when he met Jesus, he had so many questions, and Jesus had the answer. For each question he asked, met with him on his terms, provided the answer to his questions, and even with that encounter, that he could not break the bonds of self-image, of self-position, and was turned away. So this is an example that while you may have a heart for outreach, you may be seeking to bring others to the Word of God. Even Jesus set an example that some people aren't ready to be caught. So let's go fishing. First step is, where do we fish? I've always been told the best place to fish is where the fish are at. In John, we read that true followers of Christ will desire to tell others about him. Mark says that we are commanded to love our neighbors. If you've done the study on the Good Samaritan, you know that our neighbor is not the person that lives next to you. It's each and every person you encounter along your walk. In Acts, Jesus tells us to be his witness in Jerusalem, in all of Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And again in Mark, we are commanded to go into the world. Jesus even set the example by spreading the word everywhere he went, from the shores to the cities, from the towns to the churches, to the homes, to the market, and even along the dusty trails throughout his journey. He even spread the word while sitting by a well on a hot afternoon. He also gave us the key that we need a fishing party. We can't do this alone. So if we go back to our fishing example, everyone knows that fishing with a friend is better than fishing alone. Everyone has their own technique, their history, their experience that may be needed for different types of fish. When the crappie are ready to be caught, a cat fisherman might not have the right equipment. Jesus gave the example on how to build our fishing party by selecting fishermen of all different walks. He chose the 12 disciples because he knew that even the best cat fishermen can sometimes catch a pretty nice bass. So let's look at Jesus' fishing party. We have Andrew and his brother Simon, local fishermen. Simon, who wore his heart on his sleeve and let his need to defend God a little too fiercely from time to time. I can relate. We have James and John belong to a family-run commercial fishing business. We have Matthew, who's a tax collector who lived with facts and figures, a real skeptic at heart. We have Philip, who is described as having the heart for evangelism. Nathaniel, who is also known as Bartholomew, was a simple man who was known for his love of God. I would love to be a Nathaniel. Thomas, a little doubting, was outspoken skeptic, and was known as being quite the pessimist. We have James the Lesser, who was very quiet, kind of an introvert. Simon was a political activist in his younger years and known as a man of fierce loyalties, amazing passions, and courage and zeal. Judas, an evaluator, wanted the why behind, and this is Judas Thaddeus, wanted to know the why behind everything. He was also the only man to ever known to interrupt Jesus during Jesus' teachings because he had questions and he wanted answers. And then we have Judas, a betrayer who allowed his desires for money and his own plan to lead him astray. It's a weird party, not a lot in common. What they did have in common is they each had something special in their past and in their walk that was going to be used as a bait to catch more fish. So we're ready to fish. We have our group. So what do? We just run down the river and pick a fish, and that's our fish? It's not quite that easy. Some fish are looking for a way out, and they'll come right to you. Others are perfectly happy where they are. Don't really want what you're offering. Some are so stubborn that they are intent to sit in their stagnant pond until they die. We have to understand that not everyone is looking for what you're offering. Some need forgiveness because they can't forgive themselves. We learn this in the Samaritan woman's story. Some are ready to give up and just need someone to really care. We learn this in Mary's story. Some have questions. We talked about Nicodemus. Some need faith. Jesus healed the nobleman's son because of his faith. Some need a healing. We all know Lazarus' story. While the list goes on and on, one common scenario was they came to Jesus and the disciples. They made a step forward. Jesus demonstrates the perfect process for fishing is not relying on who you are, but sharing his love in you. You have to be able to take yourself out of the place and use the net he provided. The fact that we see Jesus regularly performing miracles, healing, this wasn't his net. In fact, we notice that most of the time he actually told these people, "Don't tell no one." But then time and time again, we see more and more people coming to him, seeking him out. You know, I talked about this at a different study I did about what did Jesus look like. We look at paintings all the time, the tall, skinny, white guy with the long hair. While the painting is inspired, and it, you know, I've seen several of these paintings that touched me, I don't think he was a white man. Not from the Middle East, not in that time. In fact, most descriptions are he was a man of the area. He would have blended in as far as his physical attributes. So how or what were they seeking? And I think it was what was inside of him, in his presence. He was showing the difference. He was living the net. And he was teaching the disciples to do so too. In several towns he came to, people were already talking. Have you heard of this man? Because somebody had encountered him. They were seeking him, and then they came to him. They were able to identify him, not by a physical description. There were no photos circulating with flyers going, "Come this Sunday to Judea, and you're going to see Jesus at 3 p.m. on the hillside." It was word of mouth, and they were able to find him by his walk. Based on his teachings, we must live as the lure to attract the people to Father's table. We must give ourselves and our lives, showing the same examples that he provided to the disciples. When you're fishing, would it be a surprise to learn that you're Would it be a surprise to find out that you're fishing every time you encounter anyone? When you go to the grocery store shopping, does the cashier see you as the next person in line or a child of God? When you go out to eat, does the waiter see you as the next table he has to serve or a person intent on serving all of God's children? When you go to work, are you just another one of the crew, or does your work with Christ take notice in all those around you? When the cop gave you that ticket, did he return to his car and go after the next speeder, or did he sit in his car thinking about, did this guy just thank me for keeping him safe and tell me that he would pray that I would return home each day safe and sound to my family? Last, let me ask you this. Imagine every person that you were around this last week, whether it be you had a conversation, you bumped into them, you did business with them, or you worked alongside them. If every one of them were gathered in this room right now, and we were to ask them if they knew the God you served, would any be surprised? Are there holes in your net, is what I'm asking you today. So then now we've talked about this, let's do a lesson about fishing with some great fishing stories. I've never felt that I need to post much on social media, but after I started my new life direction of saying yes to Jesus in all that I do, I started posting about Jesus, the changes he'd made in my life, the things he had done around me, the miracles I'd seen, the people he had touched, the events I had attended. I'm proud of what God's done for me and those around me. So I started posting more and more. Not for any particular reason, except for I'm happy to have him in my life and I want to share it with anybody who happened to come across. I don't have many followers. I'm not a social media person. But that's what my intent was. I didn't realize I was mending holes in my net. And then one day I took a trip to Dallas-Fort Worth, a business trip, to meet colleagues. And while on that trip with colleagues, we were in an event, a team building event, and one of my colleagues, a lady that is great, she does a great job, she works great in her work, but we don't have a lot in common. She has a really beautiful Harley Davidson. I've seen her jacket a few times, very nice. I think in a fair fight, she'd take me every time. Very abrupt, but I love her. I think she's great at her job, but we don't have a lot in common. Well, one day at this event, she asked me, hey, can we go outside and talk? I naturally assume she's got a question about work, so I'm like, sure. So we leave the event, we go outside. As we're leaving the doors to step outside, she goes, you know, I'm not spiritual. And I thought, well, where is this going? She goes, but I don't know that I believe in God. Odd conversation starter. I was kind of taken back. She continued on. She said, but you know, I've been seeing your post. And I've seen the things that you're talking about, and I've seen the changes in you. And it's got me curious. But as she talked, I could also feel there was a question, but I could also feel that there was a wall being built. She was ready for me to come at her. And I want to say thank you, God, because right then he made me realize this and he directed my steps from there. So I just continued to listen. I didn't say anything. She started talking about my encounter post, my church mentionings, just different things. And she said, so what's it about? I said, it's about a walk. And it's about a love that directed that walk. That's all I said. She started talking about something work-related. Then she come back. So I would just have to change everything I do. I said, I'm not going to ask you to change anything. We talked more about work. Conversation came on. She goes, yeah, but that event's probably only down there in your area. I said, this event is everywhere. Across the world, across the globe, in every city, in every town. You just got to ask the right person the right question, and they'll give you the answers I'm giving you today. She thanked me, and we went on. She did not accept Jesus into her life that day. That wasn't the goal. It's not my job to direct his plan. I was just there to plant a seed. The seed had first been planted when I posted something on social media with no intent other than to, I was happy about what happened. Then God said, okay, you planted it. I'm going to take you, a person from central Missouri, and I'm going to put you in contact with a person from South Dakota, and you're going to meet up in Dallas-Fort Worth. Now water your seed. That's a net. You see, the best part of fishing is telling fishing stories. I'm part of your fishing story. I am honored to be part of this church. My salvation, my testimony, my walk included in the sanctuary are all part of my net and yours. I have added Zoom post and Ashland post to my net. I have added men's encounter to my net, youth camp to my net. I've added my testimony and your testimonies to my net. I've added daily prayer, and the prayers that were answered and the prayers that have not yet been fulfilled are all part of my net. But you have the greatest net possible, and I've seen some people who have a phenomenal net, and it never leaves the box. If you're taking your testimony, your walk, your love, and you're having it at Sunday morning service only, your net is locked up in a box. Imagine if you weren't here because somebody else had kept their net locked up in a box. The net only works if we let the net into the water and let it collect the fish. In 2 Corinthians 5:10, it says that we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that we may receive back the things that were done in the body, the flesh, according to what was done, whether it be good or bad. I'm going to ask you to give me some latitude right now because I don't know what that day is going to look like, but I just want to tell you what came to my mind. I imagine on this day there's going to be a long line, everyone lined up, ready for their judgment moment. For some, this is going to be a sweet and wonderful time. They are going to be waiting for the opportunity to hear those words, "Well done, my good and faithful servant." Yet others may be a little bit fearful of hearing the words, "I never knew you." What I'm asking for you today, if your net's in a box, is to imagine being in that line and the person just ahead of you was that waiter that you talked to earlier, that cashier you saw on the way to church, that cop that stopped you yesterday, your boss or coworker from work, or any of the people that you've talked to or encountered in the last week. What if they are the person right in front of you in line, and right before their moment of judgment, they turn to you, look you dead in the eyes, and ask, "You knew about this?" "You didn't tell me? What did I do to you that was so bad that you decided to keep this from me? Why didn't you want to catch me?" This is our opportunity. The season for fishing is not known. This isn't like Missouri Conservation set a date. Fishing season could end tomorrow. It may go a bit longer, but I've got to ask you today in closing, where's your net? Are there holes in your net? Now is the opportunity. Spread your net as wide as you can. Your testimony, your presence here today is part of your net. Use it. It can be as simple as every time somebody asks you, "How are you doing?" "I'm making it through his love." When you sign an email, is his words in it? Have a conversation. Look for those in need, but also use his approach. Not everybody wants to hear, "Hey, if you don't come to church, if you don't accept Jesus Christ, some just need to know the love. Some need encouragement. Mary just needed someone to say her name. So just ask that when you leave today, spread your net as wide as you can. Help us reach as many people as possible. And then that day of judgment is going to be a day full of joy as you go, I knew that one. I knew that one. I knew that one. And then when it's your turn to stand before him, it says that once you, he tells you to come forward, your good and faithful servant, then it says you're going to reap the rewards that you earned here. It's going to be all those people who can go, thank you for telling me. Thank you for leading me. Thank you. I hope God just continues to inspire you and to guide you in your daily walk.
Please join me in the pastoral prayer. God, I pray for a world that doesn't know you. I pray for those who are lost. God, show yourself to those who don't believe. Allow me to be a source of your light to those who need help.
Help me to lead people to you.
Help me tell others about you and have the words they need to hear. I pray for divine appointments all across the world today. God, I pray for the world to know you. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, please come forward.